dismissal. For communion, for those of you who have not been here recently, we're again trying to social distance with communion. And so what that means is that the government will be first. Keep them from right back. And when you get here, you pick up a cup and wait, and I will give you a wafer here. Then you move on down, and Brian will be at his place to give you the wine or grape juice if you prefer grape juice. We do have some pre-filled glasses. And then as you receive that, go on around. And the waste basket, dispose of your glass, is back here. That's to create a little more space between this front row and people walking back. So put your cup in here and continue on around and back to your seat. Okay? And then you cut around this way. I think we'll need to take just watch out for anybody under 40 is not going to get that much. If you're laughing, I know how old you are. So that's where what we're doing for communion. And then when we leave, again, so that we don't have a crowd of people piled up at the door, so that folks are moving, keeping that nice distance so that we don't risk infecting each other, we'll dismiss by section, again, with this group here, 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 and the back. So that's what's going on there. I think that's what we need to highlight for you, except to say welcome. It's good to see some of you back. I know it's been a long year, literally a year. I could get in to see my mother yesterday. It's the first time in 13 months that I've been able to give my 93-year-old mother a hug. So things are getting better, but we're not there yet. So we still need to be a little bit careful. So keep up the good work. We have had very few folks that have had COVID in our congregation. Unfortunately, for two of them, that was fatal, and we grieve their passing. But we've been lucky in that it's been less than 5%, which is lower than the general population. So it's because we've been careful, it's because we've been cautious, and it's been because you all have been cooperating. And we haven't had the outbreaks in grace that we have seen in other congregations. So thank you for that, and thank you for your cooperation. And with that, let us begin with the celebration. Please stand and join us with the blessing of the Pope.
They went away and found a colt outside your room or outside in the street. As they were inside, and some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the rope?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his path. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you, through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace, in the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. coming to be exploited, but emptying himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Please stand for the reading of the Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now, as soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. And they bound Jesus and led him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone from whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. The chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas instead. Pilate spoke to them, "Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. And after mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out and crucified him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry Jesus' cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each one should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests along with the scribes were also mocking him among themselves, saying, "He can't save others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, dark. Darkness came over the whole land until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?" Which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." Some of them ran and filled a spoon with a sponge with sour wine and put it on a stick and gave it for him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come down to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. Then the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." There were also women looking on from a distance, and among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the Younger, and of Joseph and Salome. They used to follow him and provide for him when he was in Galilee, and there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. And Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that Jesus was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. And Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. And Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body had been laid. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. We have a response to make today to the word that we have heard. We continue to be confronted by the question of who Jesus is, and again, we see the outsider, the foreigner, the Roman centurion being the one who will confess that this is the Son of God. And I want to draw your attention to the lesson from Philippians, because the response to that recognition is worship. If this is the Son of God, then at that day every knee should bend in heaven and on earth, and then after worship is confession. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. But there's a peace before that. You know, Dr. Tom Ryan, our Old Testament professor in seminary, and he used to say that when you got to the Ten Commandments, it should say, "Because I am the Lord your God, therefore you shall have no other gods before me. You shall remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain." Because, therefore. And there is a because and therefore in this lesson to the Philippians. But it's backwards. Because of who Jesus is, therefore, every knee should bow, every tongue proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The part that goes before that is the call to discipleship. The call to follow in the way of the cross is to try and figure out what it means and to say, who are we and what does it mean for us to follow this Jesus and where are we going? Where are we following Jesus to? And yes, Jane, I know that's bad grammar. To where are we following Jesus? We are following Jesus to the cross. Now, part of the gospel story is the story of Simon of Cyrene. And when Romans crucified somebody, they really didn't care how they got the cross. But as part of the punishment, you carried your cross to your place of execution. Like picking up your own electric chair and plugging it into the wall. But if the person was too weak or too frail, they could pull somebody out of the crowd, no matter who, and make them carry that cross. And if that was you that carried that cross, the danger was you'd get there and somebody might get confused and think you were the one that was to get nailed on there. So there's a scene in Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion of Christ, where they pull Simon out of the crowd and as an artistic touch, because they were probably not there at the time. Rufus and Alexander were standing there and they try to pull their father back. And Rufus and Simon says, just so we're clear when we get there, this is not my cross. And when they get to the place of execution, he throws the cross down and runs for his life. So to what are we following Jesus? We gotta go back. In the last couple weeks of gospel lessons in the Gospel of John, so God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. And so Christ, knowing all this, willingly takes the cross and goes to die for the sake of the world. Remember, the first part of that isn't about the believing part, it's about that for God so loved the world. And so Paul says to us in this letter to the Philippians, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. He could have done it differently, he could have done it 100 different ways, he could have given all this up and said, forget it, Dad, I'm done. But he emptied himself out, he poured himself out, taking on the form of a slave, and being born of human likeness. The great God Almighty that made the universe and everything in it, came like one of us with all our alleys and bruises and cuts and bumps and everything else. Taking on human likeness and being found in human form, humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death. The God who creates the world, who creates life in the world, gives himself up to death, even death on a cross. And the message for us today is that this Christ has died on the cross for the sake of the world. Having, therefore, the same mind in you that was in Jesus Christ. And that's radical. Because we do okay if we got to sacrifice for ourselves and for our family. We do okay when we got to sacrifice for people we know, people we work with, people we care about. But when they're different, we're not so sure about how we're going to sacrifice. Are they worth dying for? States, even though they've been here for three, four, five generations, are they worth dying for? Would I die for them? Those radical people, the brown people, the black people that rioted in the streets in Washington and St. Louis, would I die for them? Those people that breached the Capitol, killed four people, killed a policeman, beat a policeman with a fire extinguisher, would I die for them? Your crazy uncle with the MAGA hat, and a little cousin that just won't stop being a bleeding heart and being sympathetic to every good cause that makes the Thanksgiving dinner discussion so interesting. Would I die for them? Gay and lesbian and transgender and homeless and all of those folks, would I die for them? Would I have in me the same mind of Christ who died for the sake of the world? Would I die for them, for people that I don't agree with and people that I don't like and people that I don't know? Would I die for them? Would I go to the cross for them? And Jesus says, absolutely. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was God, took on human form and gave himself and humbled himself even to death on a cross for the sake of the world. Therefore, God exalted him and gave him the name above every other name, that every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Because God has done this great thing for me and for you and for everybody for the sake of the world. I like peace. I know it sounds weird. I've discovered being diabetic that one peak is acceptable if you're diabetic, if you're not severe. Four peaks is the recommended serving size, but you can't eat four if you're diabetic. If you're not severe, then you can't eat one. And so Lori always gets me a box of peaks for Easter. Takes me 2 weeks to eat them. Because there's 10 in the package. I get one of them. Like old Miss White. Met Miss White when she was 100 years old. I was in high school. Didn't have any children, never married. I asked her what she wanted for her birthday, and she turned to 100. She said, box of candy. Staff in the nursing home said, she's not getting candy. Her niece sent her a box of candy. Staff took it away from her. She called her mom. She said, the woman is 100 years old. What is the worst thing that is going to happen to her if she eats this candy while she's diabetic? So they parceled it out to her one piece at a time. She got one piece of candy a day. And she got a box of chocolates for her 101st birthday. And she got a box of chocolates for her 102nd birthday. And she got a box of chocolates for her 103rd birthday. She didn't make it to her 104th birthday, but I don't think it was the chocolates. We're going to go home. We're going to get meat. We're going to get chocolate. We're going to get hot dogs. We're going to get baskets. We're going to look for the Easter bunny, see if there's any bunny tracks. You know, kids. some kids put flour out in the kitchen to see if there's any bunny tracks coming through the kitchen on the way to their Easter basket. If your mom and dad do not approve this, don't try this at home. And we want the celebration, we want the lilies, we want spring, we want your Easter finery.
Lord, and the Lord, to judge the living and the dead, and to see him who had a mind. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, and spoken through the cross. We believe in one of the one God and our fellow church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, the blood of the resurrection to the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Most gracious and loving God, we thank you for this beautiful season of renewal, with the return of color and warmth. It has been a long year of isolation, so this year we are most appreciative. Help us to protect and care for this earth by living simpler lives, Lord, in your mercy. Our words can hurt or heal. Teach us to speak with gentleness and compassion, and to have the mind of Christ toward those we meet from every race and religion. Especially we pray this day for our brothers and sisters of the age and ancestry. You made the world full of wonderful diversity of languages and cultures and created all people in your image. Free us from prejudice and fear, and bring an end to racial violence and gun violence around the world. Lord, in your mercy. As we continue this journey of Lent, we know our shouts of Hosanna will end with the death on a cross and burial of your only begotten Son. May we spend time this week at the foot of the cross, reflecting on this great sacrifice and our individual response to it. Lead us to confess Jesus as Lord, to bring others to know him. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our country, our leaders and citizens, that we would work together to bring peace, equality, and jobs back to the unemployed. Continue to decrease COVID through increased vaccines within our country and the world. Bless and protect all healthcare workers, military personnel, essential workers as they go about their daily work. Comfort the sick and dying, and bring healing as you will it to those on our prayer list. Lord, in your mercy. Sustain your church and bless congregations who have just now reopened for in-person worship. Strengthen our bishops, Elizabeth and Matthew, in their work with congregations of this nation and synod. Guide Pastor Tim and grace his counsel as we look to future projects which will increase our ministry capabilities in this time and place. Especially bless the children of grace in this community, that they may grow in faith as they learn about Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Whom else and what else should we pray this day? Lord, in your mercy.
So into your hands, O Lord, we commit all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts to those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give them thanks and prayers.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, whose suffering and death gave salvation to all the world. You gather your people around the tree of the cross, transforming death into life. And so with all the choirs of angels and the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness, the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so with this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ is alive. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love.
Come, Holy Spirit.
And so with your holy ones of all times and places, with earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars of space, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. generation of God, for the people of God, come.
For all is now ready.
Please be seated and call the invitation of God.
Take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us peace.
Grant us peace.
Please stand. God, the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need, and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and keep you forever. Amen. Let's go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.